Good morning, everyone. Good to see you this first Lord's Day of 2021. I think I remember when I was probably in about fifth grade, I expected if I lived in 2021, we would like driving cars that floated, you know, stuff like that. So it's kind of interesting. I guess that's still yet to show up yet. But it seemed like a long time away at that point, and yet we're here. Another year, we'll see. I hope that on Christmas Eve, I didn't mess anybody up. I had been in constant communication with people throughout the day. Honestly, just really hoping that we could meet and not. And from weather reports and all that, we thought good and we're okay. And we made a call, and Kathy says, "I think I can do it." And she leaves Oak Ridge, and I start getting ready. And we're gonna have, even if all we had was singers and instruments here, we were gonna put it online and do what we could. And then all of a sudden, I was getting ready, and I looked outside, and everything was covered in the roads, everything. And Kathy goes, "Look, I got so far, and I had to turn around." So hopefully, it didn't mess you up. But you got out and had any troubles, but I don't know. Seems like an appropriate way to end the year, even if it's disappointing. But anyway, we've made it to a new year. We're going to pray the Lord will do what He will with us, with His church, with us as His people, with His church everywhere. Even as life is a little bit in turmoil and continues to be. Let me share with you a couple things. I will make sure a prayer list is updated in the next couple of days and email it out. A lot of the things we've been praying for are still there, and we'll continue to do so. But a couple of things. Obviously, we're going to pray for the Lord's comfort for Doris and her family. It's, in the last few weeks after her brother's death, and with Pam Bowman and her family as they lost Wayne few weeks ago, pray for them. Also, want to mention neighbors of the Hydes before you all moved to Kingston. Dear lady who's beloved in this community in different places, Frances Ladd, who passed away yesterday from complications of COVID. We probably got to know her through her son and Grant playing baseball together. Predominantly, a few days before Thanksgiving, I met Kevin Chase, a missionary who works with Wycliffe Bible Translators, and I've maintained a relationship with him. We met for lunch in Oak Ridge, and she was there that day, looking as healthy as anything. Evidently, Lisa found some photos. She had been with a group. Was it a church group or was it work? Church group where they had gotten together. They were. Enjoying that, and then it's stunning, really. So pray for that family. I know that the Hydes know them well. They were neighbors with them. Mark teaches over there at Calvary. I didn't know that until I saw that. The son teaches over there at their school. Francis was working at Mount Pisgah, I think, the school out there. So there's various people who will. I don't know. It's tough, and I know that family will grieve heavily, and the community, her church, will miss her dearly. Let me also ask you to pray. I know Nancy Newcomb had sent me messages and would ask for earnest prayers for Sarah's family. They all are positive, and evidently Asher, one of the not the youngest, but the next one, they had to take him into Children's last night. Don't know all the details of that, but he had kind of a crisis, and they needed to get attention. Get him some special attention. So be praying for them. I think that'll do it. We will, again, I'll update the prayer list and send that out in the next day or two. Let's take just a minute to prepare our hearts as we come before the Lord this day, this first Lord's Day of a new year. Thank you. us bow down and worship. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for He is our God, and we are the people of His pasture, the flock under His care. We just read, as our adult class went through Psalm 73, and there's a point where there's an assertion, God, for God is our strength and our portion forever. Our hope in the face of any and all terrors, anxieties, frustrations and difficulties and afflictions in life, our hope is in God, our Maker, and the one who leads us as our great shepherd. Let's join together in worshiping Him today. Let's turn and sing. I think many of us enjoy this hymn and appreciate it. 642, Be Thou My Vision. Let's stand together and sing our praise and seek God in song. Let's stand again. You make the words of this great hymn the very words of our hearts. May we desire You above all things. You above all things of this life. You above all worldly aspirations. That we would love You and seek You above every desire for accomplishment of our own. We would pray that You would stir this in our hearts. That we would seek You with all of our hearts. That we would come to experience in our lives the very covenant promise of You being our God and we being Your people. That is the highest blessing, to know You, the living and true God, as our Heavenly Father, the one who cares for us and loves us deeply. We would pray that in this coming year, that You would bless us with a closer walk with you, to know you as if we were walking as friends in the morning, to know you, that you're close at hand and you're watching over us and you are guiding us by your word and spirit. We pray that you would stir in us this great desire to be closer with our Creator and our Redeemer. We give you thanks this day that we may come not in a timid approach, but in boldness, because we have been clothed and made fit in Christ Jesus, whose righteousness wraps us up. And we are coming, as you have told us, to come boldly to the throne of grace to seek you. And we would pray that you would enter in by your Spirit, lift us up and draw us near to you this day. For we come in faith, and we anticipate your blessing and your instruction and your care. For we come in through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Apostles' Creed in the front of the hymnal is our corporate confession, the ancient creed, summary of the faith. It's not everything we believe, but it's significant things that we believe about God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, our redemption in Him, and the blessings we have in His salvation. So we join together this morning, our voices aloud in unison, affirming what we believe together as Christians. Let me ask you, Christian, what is it that you believe?
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Amen. Please be seated. And if you will, turn with me in the hymnal to page 791. Perhaps I was drawn to select this reading because I was at the cemetery on Monday. I think it's an unfortunate thing, although it is an incredible message at the time of standing at the graveside. But it's unfortunate that we've almost exclusively tied this psalm to the moment of burial. And not and perhaps in funerals, but especially connected to that. I've begun to realize how often they have cemetery scenes, burial scenes in movies. And often they have the minister in charge of the priest reading the 23rd Psalm, right? I mean, it's just so tied to that. It's unfortunate because this is not a psalm about death. And it has comfort as you face death, as you're walking through the valley of the shadow of death. But it's really about God's abiding care through every stage of life, through death, and the blessing of eternal life, really. So it's very short, as a responsive reading, though can be a great encouragement to us as we start a new year to know God as our shepherd. So let's read responsibly. Psalm 23 here, 791. The Shepherd's Psalm. This is the word of the Lord. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not be in want.
He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul.
He guides me in paths of righteousness for His name's sake.
Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me.
You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies.
You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows.
Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life,
and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Amen, amen. May the Lord bless us with this reading, apply it to our hearts. May we know that we may trust Him as a gentle, caring shepherd through every stage of our lives, and know that as His sheep, we will be entered into His presence for all eternity, brought into His presence. Let's turn to 648. Of course, we understand Jesus came along and said, I am the good shepherd. So we recognize, I've in some of these sermons, tried to drive home the point that, of course, we can know about God, we can know God through His revelation of Himself, but we especially get to know God through Jesus Christ. And so our expression of love to Christ is a way of saying that we love the Lord and we trust Him as our shepherd. 648 is a wonderful hymn to sing as we come to the table today. It's a wonderful hymn to sing as we think about Christ, our good shepherd, to express very directly our love to Him for all He's done. So 648, you can remain seated as we sing. My Jesus, I love Thee. Concerns we have. Roy, still feeling pretty good? You're just carrying on. The Lord has been good. We're going to continue to pray for God's good providence. You've been diagnosed with a serious illness, and yet we don't see it. And that's, we give praise to God for that. We're going to continue to look to Him for strength to carry you on. And let's see, again, remembering, obviously, the grieving families, and of course, the Newcombs and Sarah's family, Lawson family. So let's turn to the Lord in prayer. Lord, how we are grateful for your great love to us, how marvelous it is that we have you as our God. Not only know you about you as a distant deity that is powerful to make create a universe and make all the things in it, but to know you as our personal Father, we would pray that you remain with us and help us to know you intimately and closely, to trust you, lean upon you as that one that cares deeply for us, that we would be able to affirm what we just read. Surely goodness and covenant love, covenant mercy will follow us all the days of our lives. It will be right there at hand. We will be able to rest on it and in it. We will experience it. We will feel your presence and your care over us through the various twists and turns of this life. That you would especially be there in the valley of the shadow of death, where the intimidation and the terror of our great enemy affects us so deeply, and the loss that we experience when we lose people we love. And we have some, even now, those in our church family, for Doris and her family, and for Pam and her family, as they grieve. We would pray for the presence of your Spirit to wrap them up and to provide that comfort that surpasses understanding. It's something beyond what we can even come close to offering in our human actions and words. We pray that you sustain them, that especially the gospel will be their hope. We also pray for the Ladd family, for Francis Ladd's family. I especially pray for Mark, this young man we've got to know, and all that this will mean for him, how this will affect him. Pray that you would sustain him by your grace and care for him, and as well as the other family members in this community that looked up to her and appreciated her very outgoing and friendly spirit. Lord, we would pray that we would gain a heart of discernment as we see and experience, and perhaps experience in a new way, the uncertainty of life. Lord, we know there's a day appointed for each of us that we would die and we would face judgment. We would be confronted by the living God. We pray that we can prepare for that. We'll be ready, just as Jesus taught in his parables, to be prepared. Be prepared by having faith and trust in you, to accept and rest in the Lord Jesus and his righteous atonement and his work for us. That we would be faithful and diligent in a life of obedience to your word, to love you with all of our hearts, to live according to your statutes, and to please you in all that we do. Lord, we would pray that we will be quick to confess our sins and to seek forgiveness and restoration in our faith. And in so doing, we will find assurance and comfort in knowing you. And we'll be prepared for that day, whether it comes quickly, unexpectedly, or whether we have many days and anticipate our day. Oh Lord, give us discernment. Help us to number our days, as Psalm 90 says, to consider that we are like the grass that withers. The grass withers and the flowers fall, but the word of our God stands forever. And the word of that gospel, that is the gospel, the good news of salvation by grace through faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, that will be our comfort and our strength. Lord, we would also pray for your care over those who are sick and afflicted. We want to pray for the Newcombs and especially the Lawson family. We would especially pray right now for little Asher, who has evidently been very sick. pray for your care over him. Watch over him, restore him. We would pray that you would support and encourage Sarah and Jonathan as they do their best to care for him. And we pray for the entire family that you would just watch over them as they deal with this illness. Lord, we thank you for your care that we may have. We've been invited to come and to cast our burdens upon you and have the assurance that you care for us. Help us to do so. Do so with the expectation that you will do what is good for us, your people. That you love us deeply. If you didn't love us, you wouldn't have sent Jesus and gone through so much trouble. That he would not have endured all that he did for us if all you wanted to do was condemn us. But rather, in your great mercy, you've given the Lord Jesus. He has lived for us, and he has died for us, and he was raised to win the victory. And in him, we are more than conquerors. So help us to live that way, to have faith, the faith of conquerors, and put our trust and our obedience in the Lord Jesus every day. And in it all, you will receive the glory. And we will be blessed. So we ask for that this year. We ask for that care every day that you give us. We love you, we thank you, and we ask that you hear our prayers when we come and lift them up in and through the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Ask the ushers now to come as we worship through the giving of our tithes. Grateful for every good gift. We know that everything we have is from your hand, material possessions that we have, the money that's in our checking account, but more importantly, the spiritual blessings that you've given us in Christ, that we are yours through him. It's all from you. So our worship, our offering is simply in response to the abundance you've given us, and we return this asking that you receive it and that you bless it and make our ministry effective in this place, that your name would be glorified here and everywhere. But we come and make our prayer and offering in Jesus' name. We taught his disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory. Please be seated. And we're going to turn, I'm going to read from Ephesians chapter 4, 10 through 16. I'm going to return a little bit to this general idea of presenting the sermon in such a way as to introduce you to God. You know, how do we know God? Knowing God is the highest, attainment in spiritual life. It is to know Him and for Him to know us. It is at the core of the covenant relationship, God and man. It is central to our spiritual endeavor. But one thing that's come to me, we're going to move in the direction of kind of getting to know God through studying the law of God. Okay? If that catches you by surprise, are we studying the law to know what God expects of us? Well, yes. But actually, we get to know who God is by studying what He's revealed in His expectation of us. And we're going to move in that direction. We're going to study that deeply. Knowing God and loving Him through the law. But there's an important thing here. This is probably a little, in some ways I've had this in my mind. Is how do we get to know God? What are the mechanisms in place? What is the means of the way in which we get to know God? And as we start a new year, it's a good place to start because it kind of helps us turn our attention to the things that we probably ought to as a church, as we think about the church. And so let's see what we hear here. And I'm gonna draw some points and point you to some things that are kind of beyond this text. But let's observe here what God has done to put in place a way for us to know Him. Ephesians 4, I'll start with verse 10. I know in most Bibles this is going to look like it's just arbitrarily around the middle of a paragraph. But this is where it will get us what we need to hear. Give attention, the word of the Lord. He who descended is the very one who ascended higher than all the heavens, in order to fill the whole universe. It was He who gave some to be apostles, some to be prophets, some to be evangelists, some to be pastors and teachers, to prepare God's people for works of service, so that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. Then we will no longer be infants tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching, by the cunning and craftiness of men and their deceitful scheming. Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will in all things grow up into Him who is the head, that is Christ. From Him, the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. May the Lord add His blessing to the reading and the understanding of this portion of His word. Now, you're going to have to accept the fact that I have previously made the point that especially for us, in a broader way, we can obviously get to know God, not just know about God. That's not the aim. We know about Him, but the goal of knowing about Him as He's revealed Himself is to know Him, personally, to know Him in a relationship, to draw near and to feel near to God. And so the knowing about as He's been revealed is to help us know Him. But you're going to have to accept. If you don't do this, you're going to have trouble with this, at least from this text. What I was trying to say as we approach Christmas is that for us, especially, our focus ought to be on knowing the Lord Jesus. He's God in the flesh. That's God who's come near and to come and entered into our world, into our human existence. It's God making himself known in an extremely vivid and powerful way by coming to us. When we're saying to grow in the knowledge of the Son of God, we're not saying anything different than to just grow in the knowledge of God. And there it's not knowledge, not semantic knowledge, it's not factual knowledge, it's personal knowledge, it's to know him and he to know us. And that is very central to what was being said here as the Apostle Paul is writing this epistle. And he is communicating here that Christ has ascended, you know, he who descended, okay, the Son of God who existed in glory came to the earth, did his work, but he's also ascended higher than everything to fill it all, to sit enthroned over everything. And then in doing so, he has imparted gifts to men to be used in his service and the benefit and the blessing of others. That's what is being depicted. He's ascended, bestowed gifts, and those gifts then bless his people and promote growth, promote and cultivate a knowledge of the people to God through the Son of God, and also to produce other works that are that is a blessing and a benefit to others. What we're seeing here is this, is we're seeing a picture of really the philosophy, the God's intention and purpose of the church. This is the church. And so the simple answer here, to answer the question of the title of the sermon, how do I get to know God? One of the most direct ways is to get to know God in the church, in and through the ministry of the church, that Christ himself said to the apostles, I build my church and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And here God has revealed through Paul that as Christ ascended, he has bestowed gifts, and that in the process of this ministry, through those he's gifted, in the body of believers, that we would all be built up, attaining to maturity in the knowledge of the Son of God. In the knowledge of God. There's no difference in saying the Son of God or God. To know him, to grow up and no longer be tossed here and there by all of the various ideologies and philosophies, the things that can affect us and knock us around, confuse us, but to be established and grow up in fullness of Christ in us. We knowing God through Christ in us. That's the idea. What is the mechanism of knowing God? Knowing God through the ministry that God has given us. And that is primarily known. Now, that doesn't mean there's not ministry to be had, received, and given that's not kind of in the place or under the structure of a definite identifiable church. There's certainly that. Okay? Sometimes churches even have things that extend out beyond their own ministry among themselves, and it's a great blessing to the kingdom of God. I mean, in some ways, the church's ministry is wherever Christian people are doing Christian ministry, and that may, you know, that could be anywhere. Sometimes it's through extensions of particular churches that have the means of putting something out that others can benefit from, and sometimes it's through what we call parachurch ministries that are organized not because of a particular church, but people from all over, Christians from all over may organize and conduct some kind of a ministry, a mission. But in some ways, it's even though it's not under the authority or the direction of the church, it's still, as Christian people are doing Christian ministry, it is still part of the ministry of the Word that will bless us and benefit us. So in some ways, what I'm saying is, broadly, how do we get to know God? Well, it's through this ministry of the gifts being given that gifted people are utilizing and using so that others may be edified and built up. And that is to be evident in the church. I mean, here's where I think not long ago I used the same text to talk about the model of ministry. Somebody says, what's your philosophy of ministry? I have to turn to Ephesians 4. It's not like I need to make up a philosophy of ministry. God has given us a philosophy of ministry. Christ is the head. He's ascended. He's bestowed gifts. We see of some of those offices or those gifted offices that are listed here, which are the premier and the first ones. Of course, pastor slash teacher, I think most people understand that to be two names identified with the same office, pastor teacher. And that is, that is evident and continuing in most branches of the church. We understand that role to be important. It's a ministry in all of these. There's an important ministry of the word, of proclaiming, of explaining, and of holding out the word of God, and especially the word of God as it summarizes and holds out the gospel, the good news of salvation through Jesus Christ. God has saved sinners and is bringing salvation in and through Jesus Christ. And so that's there. God has done that. He's revealed that. Yes, I know it can show up in different ways. If you look at the ways in which any one church, it may look a little different and how they do that. But the core of it, the central, core of the ministry and how it's operated is found right here. This is the flow chart. Christ bestows gifts. Those who are gifted then utilize those gifts for the edification. And it builds up the members so that then they use their gifts to help others. That's the model. That should be the kind of the central thing, no matter what the church is. If it's the small church like ours, or if it's the mega church. Now, obviously, depending on what people and gifts are given, that can vary. So what am I trying to say? If we're going to be a church that in this place here, we are getting to know God more and more. We're growing in the knowledge of God, in the knowledge of the Son of God. Then it's important that the way in which we operate as a church is following this model. It's we're enacting it the way it is in order to promote the maturity that God is saying is part of this, the growth that's a part of it. This is where we look for it. As I mentioned, the emphasis here is on the word. There's a preaching and a proclamation. This is central. We spoke about that in our adult class here. There's a word orientation. There's a message God has given. He's revealed propositional truths about what he has done and who he is and how he has brought his covenant to bear to human beings, as well as the salvation, the new covenant in Christ. And so the word is central. The preaching, the teaching, the studying of the word is central to this. And so, but that's not all. I really, when you're thinking about the ministry of the church, you think about all the means of grace. If you were to open up the back of the hymnal here to the shorter catechism, it's part of the reason why I put that verse there from Acts 2. Because you see, one of the ways that catechism number 80, a shorter catechism 88, says, what are the outward and ordinary means whereby Christ communicates us the benefits of redemption? And the answer is, the outward and ordinary means whereby Christ communicates, or no, let me say it correctly, communicateth to us the benefits of redemption are his ordinances, especially the word, the sacraments, we're going to do that, and prayer, all of which are made effectual for salvation. Those are the mechanism. Now, in a broad way, the means of grace, the ways in which we are blessed, that God's grace comes to us in a strengthening, in a nurturing and cultivating way to promote spiritual growth, can even be broader than that. But those are the central ones. The word, preaching, proclaiming, teaching, studying the word, applying it to our lives. That is part of it. The sacrament. Sacraments. Baptism and the Lord's Supper. Baptism is that initiating ceremony that marks someone off in the covenant and with Christ. But the ongoing sacrament, a visible ritual ceremony that particularly holds out to us the saving work of the Lord Jesus Christ that we regularly do, is in the form of a meal, eating. Just like, you know, it tells us of this need, this ongoing need to rely on Christ in faith. Just as much as you must eat regularly a good, healthy diet to live physically, so we must continually depend and feed on Christ. A meal, something that we feed on, represents, and then of course the elements themselves, his body and his blood. And the sacraments are part of that. We're to do it. We here in this place do it once a month. It's regular. I now think back about the church I grew up in, and the fact that, and other churches that have been part of it, I know about that they do it quarterly. When we were in seminary in Mississippi, they had a rotation of helpers in the nursery. And we come to realize that because they just took one quarter and popped it on the next one, and popped it on the next one, the schedule was the same. That's the easiest way to do it, right? There's no need to rewrite something that's already written. They just take the schedule. That means the same person, each quarter, because it was only quarterly communion, the same person was in the nursery every time communion popped up. You know who that person was? Lisa Jenkins. That's why we realize all of a sudden, wait a minute. It's been 9 months since her church has had communion and she has been able to just be a participant or whatever. It shouldn't be that way. I mean, I'm not gonna fight anybody over monthly, weekly, bi-weekly, you know, all that sort of thing. But I do think the Lord says, as often as you do this, there's kind of an implied message. You do it regularly. You do it to where you don't forget the last time you did it. Or realize all of a sudden, wait a minute, I haven't come to the table. And we shouldn't overlook that. So, you know, these are things that Christ has given to the church. The means of grace, word, sacrament, and of course, prayer corporately. I know. And look, my pastoral prayer is really, you're going to laugh at this. It's not long. Some of you know, you've been in churches, and you're like, yeah, man, that was a short pastoral prayer. And most of you are going, yeah, it's just hard for me to stay focused that long. I don't think, Justin there, who knows, they may be watching right now. But Justin told me, to, wow, I was overwhelmed how long that prayer was. And I would have probably failed in worship class because it wasn't long enough. I understand. When somebody else, you know what, I get lost in it. You know why? Because I'm the one praying. And I know that's hard when you're just listening. But you realize when we get, have you ever been in a worship service or observed a worship service and you realize, goodness, I think they went for an hour and 15 minutes and the only prayer I remember was some real, like real superficial thing. It was just said, Lord bless our worship, blah, 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 thank you, blah, blah, and went on. And it was real casual. That prayer, that our communicating with God and our public worship is central. If we casually treat that, then most likely we're just going to continue to casually treat it, even on our own. Our prayer, and individually, prayer. Probably universally, people would agree. Even the best prayer warriors we have, if you ask them, how's your prayer life? Oh, it's bad. I'm just struggling. Everybody's going to struggle. You know why? That's just, we're carrying around the sinful flesh with us. We're distracted. We're weighed down. Probably one of the best things to do when it's hard to pray, when you're sitting there to pray, is the first prayer is, Lord, it's hard for me to pray right now. Just that would be the very first words coming out of your mouth. Just open up and be honest. And by the way, the amount of time and the eloquence is not significant to the Lord. You know why I know that? One, Jesus denounced the eloquence of the scribes and Pharisees. He says, that's not what prayer is about. He says, you know, the best prayer is when you go and hide yourself in the closet. God's not impressed by all that. It's honesty. It's just opening up and honesty. And you know why I know length of time is not important? Even after I told you about all that. Because when he was asked how we're to pray, he gave the Lord's Prayer. How long does it take to do that prayer? It's a model prayer. It's not he didn't just say do this verbatim. It's more of a model. Here's the general way to pray. Here are the things to be concerned about when you pray. Short. Doesn't take long at all. If you could pray a prayer like that, similar to that, with those issues on your heart, with true honesty and trust and sincerity, lifting up to God, that's going to be prayer that's honored. Anyway, let me get back. The means of grace, we get to know God through the church, and the church, the gifting and the prescription that he's given to us, the way in which we're to conduct ourselves, word, sacrament, prayer. Now, there's other things. You know, the entire worship can be a means of grace. I've told you before how, yes, that thing, that creed that can be very rote, and I try to mix those up, you know, so that we're not just doing the Apostles' Creed every time until the Lord's Supper. And by the way, I missed it today. We usually do the Nicene Creed on the Lord's Supper. This first Sunday change of schedule has me all off. But there's nothing sacrosanct about that. We'll do the Nicene Creed some other time. But mix it up so it helps. But what seems to be rote and you can almost do by autopilot can be an incredibly powerful thing, because I'm standing up here and I hear your voices. And the fact that we're together, our voices together, we're in this together. We're unified. We are one in Christ. Our common Lord. As different as we all are, you know what's the same? We've received Jesus Christ as our Lord. We believe that he came as the Son of God and he laid himself down in sacrifice for our sins. And we believe that he was raised again to fully and completely secure our justification. A legal pardon before the King of Heaven, the great judge. We all have that in common, as different as we are. We share that together. Where do you learn that? You learn it here in the church. The means of grace continue to support us in this and nurture us and cultivate the knowledge of the Son of God, as it says. Now, why would I be thinking about this right now? Of course, of various events. We had been in a conversation with a presbytery. Some of the leaders know this. And they had asked us to consider getting involved with a revitalization ministry. And they offered different ideas. And one of them is called Embers to a Flame. It is one that is now, well, it has been. Harry Reeder is the senior pastor at Briarwood Presbyterian Church in Birmingham, one of our flagship PCA churches, and historically very significant. And he has had two churches that he's kind of revitalized and they've grown, and he believes very strongly that God has given us very good principles to go in terms of revitalization. In the course of that conversation, one of the pastors of the presbytery says, you know, from my observation, you are what is called an ordinary means of grace church. A number of years ago, when after hearing about his ministry at the General Assembly, we decided we wanted to invite a guy named Don Clements, who had this ministry to small churches to help them do vision planning and all this sort of thing. And when we got done by going through all the process, you know what Don Clements said? He says, oh, you're an ordinary means of grace church. Now, one of the ways of understanding, that's a term that's being used. They pull that from the catechism, okay? But one of the ways of pointing that out is, like, you know, generally small churches are kind of almost naturally going to be identified that way, because what they're saying is, look, your interest, your values, the way you operate, who you have, the gifts that you have available, doesn't put you in the category of some churches where they can kind of be very creative in conducting all of these real, you know, particular specified ministries to their community and mission oriented, all this sort of thing. Essentially, the core of our ministry is to focus on making the best effort we can with the help of the Holy Spirit to conduct the ordinary means of grace as well as we can. So our schedule, the way we operate, is it just identifies, oh, you're the ordinary means. That's what you're focused on. And that's what seems to be what's there. Now, I don't know what participating in, I know some of you are ready, there's others who are ready to go through and listen to the conference and be part of that. And to do that, I have read the book. I know what the general principles are. I know at least that it exists in the conference. I don't know how any discussions may be different. But here's the thing. I'm okay with being an ordinary means of grace church because that's what God says the church is. Christ has ascended, bestowed gifts to his church, and those gifted people are to conduct a ministry of word, sacrament, prayer that builds up the membership, and those members have their gifts that then they enact in works of service to also together build each other up. Some people, I understand, some people could look at our little church and go, man, that's a failing, stagnant church. And there's probably a number of issues that we could identify and we could address and talk about. And we'd get more depressed and we'd get probably upset. But I know this, I know there's a group of people here who love to come and worship the living God. I know there are people here who hunger to hear the word preached, to be nourished by the very words that God has revealed to us. Whatever else we may struggle with in trying to identify who we are, how we're supposed to act, what else we're supposed to be doing, if we fail to do this, we will have failed no matter what we're doing. Christ has bestowed gifts upon us. Now that's where we need to pray for discernment. What are those gifts? How do we use them to build one another up? How do we make this, how do we, in our with our, you know, group of people, how do we try to share this incredible salvation with those outside the church? How do we do it? Not how do they do it? How does that church over there, how about the one with all the people going to it? How are they doing it? What about that one out there, you know, that is doing it? Not how that, how do we? How has God gifted us? Now, I wish I knew all the answers to that. And maybe through a process, there can be some discernment and we can enhance that. But I guess what I'm drawing you back to today is, if knowing God is the highest end, to glorify God, to know him and to glorify him is the highest end, and God has given this magnitude, then that, you know, you can't pull our attention away from the means of grace, word, sacrament, prayer, the ministry of the church for one another, growing in grace. I mean, what would a church that's not an ordinary means of grace church look like, even if they're real complex? Would that be a church? Or are you just saying they've got all this stuff going on and that's just, okay, we just presuppose that that's, well, the word being proclaimed, the sacraments to celebrate and to be renewed and cultivated, the strength of our faith cultivated in prayer. That's what we're about. You can see the early church. Why did God put it in there? It's written in descriptive terms. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, fellowship, the breaking of bread, and prayers. Day after day, they attending in the temple together, breaking bread in their homes, where they received food with glad and generous hearts. It's written in descriptive terms, like, well, that's what happened to them. But you see, the reason God put it is to put it there as example. This is what a vibrant, healthy, Christian community, a church, looks like. Devoted to the apostles' teaching, fellowship, breaking of bread together, and prayer. So what I will ask you to do is to be in prayer. Plead, petition the Lord to give wisdom to me and to others who will go through the conference, and we will discuss as leaders. How do we do that well? How can we do it better? COVID is going to go away. I mean, I don't know if we'll have to deal with this every year, thinking about this stuff, but I do think it will improve. Then we must kind of be ready to turn our attention. I am thankful for people who have needed to play it safe but have joined online. I am thankful for those of you who've come and safely gathered and not been irresponsible. I've had people ask, well, when did you open back up? So, well, we never really quit it. How's it going? I said, well, you know, yes, we have some things that have disrupted, but you know what? We're just continuing to worship the Lord and seeking Him. We're trying to do it safely, responsibly. Why? Because that's who we are. It's what Christ has given us to do. Now, let me wrap this up and say, yeah, we are an Ordinary Means of Grace church because that's what Christ expects of all of His churches. We will pray for wisdom and discernment of how to move on and improve. But to do so, we need Him. It's not something we can produce. We need God in Christ through the Spirit to guide us. And with that, let us now come to the table and let's feed on Him. Once again, renew our faith. And once again, say, we need Christ. Our lives are in Him. Let's ask the elders to come as we do so.
Institution that Paul showed with the Corinthian church as he wrote them. He says, I received from the Lord, but I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, he took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. Whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until He comes. We do this because Jesus told us to. And we do it regularly because He told us to. As often as you do this, you proclaim the Lord's death. We receive, but we are also proclaiming. We are doing something. If a stranger walked in right now, even if they didn't quite know, they'd at least know. If you participate in this, oh, those people believe in that, whatever that would be to them, we can explain to them. We believe in Jesus. It is you affirming your faith and trust in Christ again. It's also a meal. Just as food nourishes our body, so participating in this meal is that we believe that the grace that is in imparted is a grace of strengthening and nourishing of our faith. When you come in faith, and you receive it in good conscience, the Holy Spirit uses this bread and juice as a set apart to strengthen your faith, to strengthen you. Christians, those who profess faith, have been marked off in baptism in the church, come and commune with your Lord today with grateful hearts. It's for Christians only, those who do not believe. Just observe the message coming. If for some reason someone could not in good conscience, sincere faith and trust, or perhaps recognizing a very sincere disobedience or sinfulness, you should, as a personal discipline, let it pass. But come and confess your sin to the Lord and find forgiveness. Forgiveness is held out to us, because Christ died for us to pay the penalty for sin. But I don't want Christians to over-scrutinize. If you can come today in faith, confess your sin, and receive the suffering, come and be blessed by your Lord. Lord, we ask now that you set apart this bread and juice for its holy use. Holy Spirit, as we partake in faith, strengthen our hearts. Help us to love Jesus more for all that he's done. Help us to lean upon the guidance of the Spirit, and help us to glorify God the Father. We would pray that you now do what you intend to do through this ceremonial covenant meal for us, your people. But we come in faith and trust in the Lord Jesus. Amen. By way of reminder, the elders will have bread in a cup on one tray and juice in a cup on the other, and they will come to each person. We'll do both at the end. And in that supper of the Passover meal, Jesus took the bread and broke it. He said, "This is my body given for you." He taught them that the bread represented what represented him, what he was offering. And then the cup, and he took the cup. He said, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood shed for men, for the forgiveness of sins." And I will instruct you once you do the elements. For your sins. Again, amen. As I said a minute ago, after the supper, giving thanks Jesus took the cup. He said, this cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for many for the forgiveness of sins. Take and drink all of you. Drink with thanksgiving for the forgiveness of your sins in Christ. Lord, how sweet it is. We have tasted and seen how good you are. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for going the whole way to observe the law of God at every point. Offer yourself willingly in sacrifice for sins, who also was raised in victory, is now ascended to the right hand of the Father. You bestowed upon your people gifts. Now lead us by your Spirit. Teach us by your word. Help us to live obediently and faithfully to serve you well and to build one another up in the faith as we trust in you. Lead us in paths of righteousness for your name's sake. For we pray in Christ our Lord. Amen. Final hymn, we'll sing the first verse of 347. 347, the church's one foundation. First verse is Jesus Christ our Lord. Stand together, 347. First verse one. Purchasing those, and they decorate nicely for December and now for one Sunday in January. Anyway, receive the Lord's blessing. May the grace and peace of the Lord Jesus be with you all this day and forevermore. Amen. Go in peace.
Thank you all.